Welcome to Christian Living 101 Bible Studies. Our mission is to prepare every believer for the trials of daily life. Listen to God's Word presented without church or organizational bias as you study with Pastor Applegate. Now we join Christian Living 101 in progress.
Our country seems to be in a turmoil right now, and a lot of people don't know what to think of it, wondering what's going to happen. And of course, none of us know, but there's one thing we do know. We serve a God that is almighty, that is all-powerful, that has great concern for His people and cares about them very, very much. I want to talk to you about some promises that He made at Ephesus, and we'll be reading Ephesians chapter 1, beginning with verse 3. And these are different elements of God's covenant with Israel. And you know, and I know, that as we think about the old Israel, we also have the old Israel very present with us still today. And we want to talk about that. And I hope that these words will encourage you, that you'll come to a place where you really are at peace in your spirit, and realize that Almighty God, who is our Lord and our Redeemer and our coming King, is able to take care of situation and guide and direct us and give us wisdom and knowledge. And so I trust that these few verses will be uplifting to your heart and cause your spirit to be found in peace at the promise of God to His people. Ephesians chapter 1, verse 3. Blessed be the God and the Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, who hath blessed us with all spiritual blessings in heavenly places in Christ. If you've come to know the Lord Jesus Christ as your personal Savior, as your Lord and coming King, the Redeemer of your soul, and the knowledge that He paid the price that you might be cleansed from your sin and walk in the perfect righteousness and peace of the Lord Jesus Christ in our day, no matter what the problems or the difficulties may be. It's important for us to just settle our mind in and think about it for a moment and think, now, Lord, I'm here in your presence. I'm hearing your word. I'm going to stand on the covenant commitment that you made unto us so long ago through the Apostle Paul. And so going on now to verse 4, we find it says, according as He hath chosen us in Him before the foundation of the world, that we should be holy and without blame before Him in love. Now, that's a verse that is misapplied and misinterpreted by many today, but I want to share some thoughts with you. According as He hath chosen us in Him. And I often have been maybe guilty of it myself, probably I have been, and probably you have been, saying, well, you know, I found the Lord on a certain time, or I came to the Lord on a certain time. And we find that the Bible makes it very, very plain that before we were ever born, before the world was ever formed, when God formed it and put it all together as it should be, we find that He had in mind that He was going to create a people for Himself. He was going to look unto those people as a place to reveal His power, His glory, His ability, and His love and care and righteousness that He wanted to bestow upon the earth that He had created and brought into a shape and form and cause it to be glorified by a people that could walk with God and could really live in a righteous state and be an overcomer, as it were, against the powers of darkness. Well, what happened? We know that, first of all, He had chosen us before we were ever created. In fact, he chose us before we were ever conceived. But when we were conceived, we were conceived to be a person that was upright, holy, righteous, and pure, that would glorify Almighty God, and that would be a testimony of God's beauty and ability as He had created the beautiful heavens and the earth and the firmament above and the sea. And oh my, you think of all of the beautiful, beautiful places that we look at today, just wherever we go, we say, that's a beautiful scene. Look at that over there. Wow, that's really something. Well, God made that. Yes, God made that. And in fact, He made you and me. And we hear that quite often, I think. So I want to remind you that when you feel the tug of the Holy Spirit upon your spirit, saying, I want you to serve me, I want you to live for me, I want you to accept the sacrificial offering of my Heavenly Father, the Redeemer that was brought forth as the sacrificial offering for those who were caught up in sin. Now, why did that become important? I've talked to you about it now for the last 3 weeks. I'll be brief, but I want to remind you that He made a perfect man, or breathed into his nose, the Bible says, the breath of God. He became a living soul, and as he failed God, was tempted by the devil himself, and failed God, and became a sinner. The Lord had already forecast or known that that was going to happen. And so He chose us as we were selected to receive the Word of God, the blessing of God, and the eternal covenant of God to minister to those who would serve Him in righteousness. So we are chosen. Remember, you were already chosen. Now, the enemy comes to you, and what does he do? He comes and says, you're not worthy to serve the Lord. What do you answer? Oh, yes, I am. Well, no, you're not. But yes, you are. And you are because God chose you. You are because God said to you, I want you to serve me. And God wouldn't have said, I want you to serve me, if we weren't the one that He wanted Himself to enjoy. Now, verse number 5. This word has 5 different meanings in the original Greek. And it's the word that everybody hangs on to and say, well, you know, I know God chose us. I know that I'm predestined, and because I'm predestined by God, I can't fail once I accept Jesus as my Lord and my Redeemer. I can go on and just live like I always did. Don't matter. Talked to you a whole week about that last week. And so we find that that word of predestination in this application means that He foresaw the need and determined that He was going to make a way for those who would choose to accept His offer to serve Him. It doesn't mean that He said, I've chosen you and you have to serve me. Because you see, when God made man, He made him in His own image. Well, I'll tell you what, I hate to spring this on you folks, but there's not a living creature or a living person or a dead one on the face of the earth that is able to be compelled to serve God, because God doesn't work that way. God uses this word. He says, I'm showing you my will. I'm showing you my desire. I'm showing you the reason I created you and the reason that I've called you now to serve me. And it is simply a situation where He said, if you will live by the standards that I ask you to live by, and you accept the sacrificial lamb that died on the cross of Calvary for your sins, that he might be able to forgive your sins. And if you do that, and if you understand that I will keep my word, and here it is, and so I lay it out for you. That doesn't mean that you are forced to receive it. You see, the human being, man himself, is made in the image of God. They're the only vessels on the face of the earth that can reason, that can fellowship, that can enjoy, that can make decisions, that can serve others and have a place of great appreciation in the kingdom of God as they radiate the glory of God in behalf of those who are lesser in knowledge or understanding of what God has done for them in giving us the Lord Jesus Christ. And so here's the will, the desire, it's laid out on the table, and it says, whosoever believes on the Lord Jesus Christ shall be saved. Well, that means that we have the power of choice. If we choose to accept God's offer, then we accept all that goes with it. We get the benefits of all that goes with it. But if we don't accept it, and we don't obey it, and we don't live by a standard, then it doesn't apply to us anymore. And we have to understand that. In verse 6, it says, to the praise of the glory of his grace, wherein he hath made us accepted in the beloved. In other words, God is a God of love. Though you've also heard me tell you, he's also a God of judgment. But he is a God that will not compromise righteousness for anything, right, or purpose on the face of the earth in the heavens above. And so it is that we are literally living as a select member of the kingdom of God upon our acceptance of his plan for our life. If we don't want to live by that plan, then of course the benefits of that plan do not belong to us. Verse 7, in whom we have redemption. That word redemption means a separate, special value through his blood for the forgiveness of sins according to the riches of his grace. In other words, we are supposed to be, when we come to the knowledge of the Lord Jesus Christ as our Lord and Redeemer, knowing that we are redeemed through the price that the sacrificial Lamb of God paid for our redemption on the cross of Calvary, then we can say, yes, I am a child of the King. I am a member of the kingdom of God. Verse 8, wherein he hath abounded toward us in all wisdom and prudence. Oh, what does that mean? That is a little short verse that says God has abounded in wisdom and prudence. You mean God had wisdom in choosing me? The Bible says he did. You mean he had good prudence, means good judgment. You mean he had good judgment when he chose me? Sure did. You are the most valued element of God's creation. Once you come to that place, you will live in a knowledge of the true love, the true wisdom, the true power, ability, originality, all of the glorious, wonderful things that Almighty God is, you become a participant in because he saw the need and knew that The wages of sin, I've said it every time I have a study, the wages of sin is death. And it's not talking about the tangible death of this old body of ours when it wears out or gets damaged and we don't breathe through it anymore. It's of no use to us anymore. It's not talking about that. It's talking about the spirit, the real you, the character, the element of life that God placed into Adam before he blew it. And now, since he did blow it, and again, yes, I know, I say this all the time, but you need to remember, you are worthy because Jesus Christ died for your faults, for your sin, for your inability to be righteous and holy. Because, you see, you, when you were born, were already born with the Spirit within you that was dormant and inactive because of the sin of your forefathers and of the parents who caused you to be conceived and have a life on this earth. Verse 9, having made known unto us the mystery of his will. Well, I don't know how many of you might have experienced this, but I have been privileged by the grace of God to experience so much of his love and his glory, of his power, of his grace and mercy, of his ability to deal with any situation. And there's been more than once in my life as I've been going through a hard place or an inexperienced place, and I really don't know what is really going on, and I see how God works it all out, brings it to a point of conclusion and understandable, and how God intervenes and brings it to be a blessing instead of a problem and a curse or a disappointment of any kind, and God puts it all together. And when that happens, how often have I said, and I'm sure you have too, why me? In fact, I'll just confess, when he called me into the ministry when I was 17 years old, and I entered into it, preached my first sermon, and then, of course, went on to college, and I got a little education there, and then I went out and I began to minister the Word of God. And God kept his Word. And when I would pray and use the name of Jesus, you could see the power of the Holy Spirit bring life into that situation. If I was praying for someone and they were being healed, the power of the Holy Spirit would come upon them. The glory of God would fill them in their spirit, and the miracle would take place. And I've often said, why me, Lord? Why did you choose me? Well, what is that? That is one of two things. It's either unbelief or it's amazement beyond comprehension. And it isn't that I don't believe, and it isn't that you don't believe, but I think every one of us, as we look and see what God does, how he intervenes in our behalf, how the promise of his word is so true, and how no matter what the situation, there's a situation and scripture within the word of God that deals with it, and it's all there. And I begin to say, Lord, why me? I'm not worthy. Well, I'm not worthy in myself. But I am worthy as a vessel of God that has acknowledged that the great promise and gift and remedy for the pit that I had fallen into before I was conceived, because I was conceived with an unclean, unrighteous spirit within. I inherited it all the way back to Adam, and I've talked about that a long time, a lot of times, and I'm going to leave it there. You already know what I mean and what I'm talking about if you've listened to me before, if you've read the Word of God. Wherein he hath abounded toward us in all wisdom and prudence. And that's a bold opportunity that he reveals to us, allowing us to receive the mystery of his will. And when you stop and think about it, I'm just a little tiny ant in compared to all of the creatures upon the face of the earth, the sea below, the air above, heaven itself, hell. Oh, I don't ever want to be a part of hell. Anyway, there we are. Verse 10, in the dispensation appointed of the fullness of times, he might gather together in one all things in Christ, both which are in heaven and which are on earth, and even in him. All of his glory, all of his help, all of his ability, and even the fact that he trusted us to have the ability to make our own decisions. And then, even when we fell into sin because of another, because of inheriting it from the seed that was planted in our parents' lives. And so what happens? Verse 11. In whom also we have obtained an inheritance. Here's that word predestinated again. Being predestinated, that means that we have been given a contract, a promise, a possession, if you please, of inheritance into the eternal kingdom of Almighty God. See, God is eternal. God is everywhere present. God is total ability. God is absolute power and authority. God is equipped with everything it takes to make frail, unprepared, unequipped individuals like you and me be worthy and capable of the promise he made to correct a death sentence that was placed upon our life by another creature that we had no control over at all. And so because Adam failed, every descendant of Adam is born in a condition of sin. The Bible says that. Why? Because the Spirit of God, the righteousness of God that was breathed into Adam, was killed the minute Adam took of the forbidden fruit and ate it. And thereby, God said, if you do, you'll surely die. And he did. Oh, he lived for another many years. But at the same time, he lived that in a dormant spirit, with a dormant spirit, that he had no ability to change and do anything about. But God did. So, it was in God that we obtained an inheritance, because he determined that because one man caused all this to come upon all other men, then we have to assume, wait a minute. You don't dare talk like that. We're living in an age where we're talking about equality. And we're not talking about man. No. Well, if you read the Bible, when he created Adam, he also made Eve. And he said he made them male and female. The problem is, the unknowing and unbelieving female has that old spirit within that's not been changed and born again. And so there's something within her that wants to be not only equal with the man, but she wants to rule over the man. Well, where did that come from? It came from the seed of Satan in Adam. So verse 11 said, we have an inheritance. Well, what is the inheritance? We have the privilege of knowing the will of God for our being, and really the offspring that we bring forth, our children, has the same promise that we do if they will take advantage of it. And if we don't take advantage of it, we're going to remain bound up in the law of sin and death, spiritual death, yes, but physical death as well. Now, all of us are going to die in the physical. There's no doubt about that. Only two men, as far as I can understand, maybe three, have been caught up to be with the Lord without shedding the old carnal body first. But the norm is this old body of ours will grow old and wear out. Now, I used to think that old age was when you turned 30. Because when I was thinking that way, I was about 12 years old. And every day and every month seemed like a long time for a youngster who was born in poverty and doesn't have much to do with anything, and life is hard, and oh, that person that's up there, and they come to work, they've got a good job, probably build a nice home, come to a place where they're maybe in business, and the kid looks at it and says, man, that is awesome. How in the world did that happen? That's an old man. Well, how old? Oh, 30 years old. Well, let me tell you something. That's just a kid today. To me. Why? Because I've lived a lot of days and a lot of years. And I've lived long enough to tell you that in serving the Lord all of those 75 years, that I've come to the place, now I'm not talking about when I was little, maybe I didn't know any different. I'm talking about serving God for 75 years. And I see His work and His handiwork. I've seen what He does in the lives of others. I see how very compassionate and long-suffering and full of grace and mercy that He is. And yes, even today, in my heart, I have to say, Lord, I don't deserve this. I don't deserve this. And you know what? I don't. But I do, because God made me worthy if I would accept His gift to set me free from the bondage of the law of sin and death. Now, let me tell you something. I've said this in some way before, I'm sure. But I want to tell you something. Sin can look so nice and wonderful and make you happy and get out of your head, and drugs or alcohol or whatever, and you're just a world is all right until you have the hangover. You don't have a hangover when you serve the Lord. It comes to a point where you begin to understand how awesome Almighty God, our Heavenly Father, is. Because He said, if you will accept the price that I have to offer to change what Adam did, I will give you the righteousness that I gave Adam. And I will expect you to keep that righteousness and to live in it until the time comes when the work that I've determined that you are to accomplish in my name is full and complete, and I take you home to be with me, eternally, spiritually. Oh, but what am I going to do? I don't want to be just a spirit floating around in the air. Oh, no. You see, this body is going to be transformed into spiritual form, and we're going to have the righteousness and the righteous flesh, the carnal flesh that Adam had, and it's going to come into new birth through the Lord Jesus Christ, the Lamb of God, who canceled out. We're hearing a lot about the canceling thing today, political garbage, but there's some spiritual truth about that word. When we are born again into the kingdom of God, God cancels, blots out, the Bible says, our sin from the remembrance of God Himself. Think about that. Go on with me now to verse 12. That we should be to the praise of His glory who first trusted in Christ. Paul was telling the church at Ephesus, you have accepted the Lord Jesus Christ as your Lord. You've accepted the Lamb that was offered for your sin to eradicate it, to blot it out, to cancel it. And so because of that, you now have the ability to be the praise of God's glory. And Paul was saying the church at Ephesus, because they were the first generation that could be cleansed by the blood of Jesus. Jesus had died on the cross not many years before this was given unto Paul and written for our well-being and understanding in the day in which we live, so many hundreds of years later. Verse 13, in whom ye also trusted, after that you heard the word of truth, the gospel of your salvation, in whom also that ye believed, you were sealed with that Holy Spirit of promise. Praise the name of the Lord. Oh, well, praise God. That means it really doesn't matter if I sin, because it says I'm sealed with that Holy Spirit of promise. No. It says that you are marked as a child of Almighty God with the Holy Spirit of the living God of promise. What was the promise? Which is the earnest of our inheritance until the redemption of the purchased possession unto the praise of His glory. You see, if somebody in your family or a friend or business associate, and they're well endowed with the things of this earth, and they look at you and they say, you know, I'm getting up in years, and I know I'm going to go meet my Lord one of these days, and God has blessed me with all of these possessions and given me all of this blessing and situation that is so wonderful and valuable, and I want to be sure it stays in the family, or this friend is such a blessing to me that I don't have a family, I'm going to will it all to him. Or maybe a situation where they're going to will it all to their children, which is most generally the case. Well, that will has no effect until they die. We have to understand that. And so, we are sealed with the Holy Spirit of promise, which is the earnest, that means certified commitment of the giver of our inheritance until what? The redemption of the purchased possession unto the praise of His glory becomes activated. Well, it only comes activated when the receiver of the will has access to it, and it's only valid once that person passes on into eternity. And what it's saying is, what God has promised to you is irrevocable. You cannot lose it. It isn't something that He'll forget. It isn't something that somehow or another It just belongs to somebody that did a better job than you did. Nope. It's a promise to you. It's a certified commitment. It stands. It has your name on it. And it is not revocable. Now, that doesn't mean that you can refuse to take possession of it. And you see, wherefore, verse 15, I also, after I heard of your faith in the Lord Jesus and love unto all the saints, verse 16, I cease not to give thanks for you, making mention of you in my prayers. Why? Because you have joined a fellowship of believers, a fellowship of born-again Christians, a fellowship that is able to understand being recreated supernaturally in our spirit and cleansed because Jesus paid the price for our inherited sin. Verse 17, all of that happens that the God of our Lord Jesus Christ, the Father of glory, may give unto you the spirit of wisdom and revelation in the knowledge of Him. Now, if you're a Christian and you love the Lord and you've made a commitment to the Lord and you really know that you've been born again, the spirit within you has been changed, and that's all good. But you may say, but I don't understand. I don't see. I don't comprehend. But you see, the Apostle Paul was explaining to the new birth Christians in Ephesus that because they have accepted Jesus as Lord and Redeemer and believe upon Him and have joined into fellowship with other Christians and belong to the eternal kingdom of God throughout the ages to come, whether they depart this body or not, the spirit of wisdom and revelation of the knowledge of God is going to become revealed unto them. Well, have you noticed? If you read the Bible, you're going to read a scripture, you're going to say, well, that's new. I never saw that before. And you look and, I wonder when that got in there. I never saw that before. Well, why didn't you see it before? Because the spirit within you was dumb. Maybe that's a bad word. Was dormant, without life. Oh, the spirit of the human body was still there. But the body's going to be displaced one of these days. See, what you have to realize is that when you die, your spirit leaves this body, you breathe your last breath, God says that you have a certified commitment that is unrevocable. It can't be changed unless you have changed it yourself by refusing to follow the instructions that makes it valid. Well, the instructions that makes it valid is if you accept Christ, He will give you the strength, the wisdom, the knowledge, and the understanding that enables you to say, hey, I'm not very good at myself, I know that, but I've been cleansed by the blood of the Lamb. I've been anointed by the Holy Spirit. I've been chosen by Almighty God. I've been set apart unto the kingdom of God for the ages to come. And so when I leave this old earth and my body lies empty and dead and dormant, my life in eternity has just begun. And I'm going to live in that for the ages to come if I have been faithful unto the conditions of the will that God wrote out for me, certified it, said it was not revocable, and I had a welcome birth certificate to the house of God and the membership of the kingdom as I have continued to serve the Lord now, having been born again by the power of Jesus' blood and the Holy Spirit of the living God. And then verse 19 goes on and it says, and what is the exceeding greatness of his power to us word who believe according to the working of the mighty power. In other words, I'm going to begin to understand the supernatural power and authority that I have in this old carnal body of mine once that spirit that was dormant within me is born again and now is membership in the kingdom of God. And I begin to see the greatness of his power. I begin to understand the way that he does things. I begin to have confidence in the ability, his ability being above and beyond anything and everyone, every situation upon the face of the earth or in it. And I begin to get an insight and an understanding of the mighty God that gave me the Lord Jesus Christ to set me free from the bondage of the law of sin, which is spiritual damnation and death. Well, let's go to verse 21. I want you to catch this because it's a continuation of Paul's description of what happens to those who are genuinely converted, accept the fact that Jesus died for their sin, and follow through with the conditions of the will being applied to them. Here's what it gives you. Far above all principality and power and might and dominion, and every name that is named, not only in this world, but also in that which is to come. When you breathe your last breath, you're going to understand that perfectly. But until then, you better take it by faith. God will reveal it to you step by step. But once you walk into that spiritual presence of God because of the new birth in Christ, you're going to have understanding of the absolute authority of Almighty God. But if you really are committed to live for God and walk in His presence and live by His decrees and the will that He has given you, that the Lord has shared with you and given us in the Scriptures, if you will do that, then you're going to come to a place where now you're going to understand what it means. And it's talking about the Son, the Lord Jesus Christ. We have absolute authority through Jesus now. We have to realize that when Jesus rose from the dead, He had all the power and authority of the Heavenly Father. And so it says, and so God has given Jesus all things under His feet and gave Him to be the head over all things to the church. God empowered the only begotten Son, the Lamb of God, to eradicate the damage, the judgment of the sin of Adam when Adam failed to obey God. Now in verse 23, which is His body, the fullness of Him that filleth all in all. And with that, the Bible tells us that we become a joint heir with the Lord Jesus Christ. That means you become a member of the eternal kingdom of God, and you have been now given the same privilege, power, authority, ability, access unto the Heavenly Father. On and on we could go. Because God said, if you serve me through Jesus' power and cleansing ability as he shed his blood for you, if you'll live by that standard, then I'll make you an equal heir. I'll make it a little bit plainer. I'll make you an equal inheritor. Now, what are you going to do with Jesus? Some of you have accepted him. I know you will love the Lord. I know you want to serve the Lord. I know that some of you are conscientious and really try to keep the Word of God that Jesus gave to us as he ministered the God's will here on the earth. But somehow or another, you've grown cold. Trials and troubles have come. The word that you heard that was partly true, but distorted and violated and made of no use. As you listen to the old enemy say, well, you don't have to worry about anything. You know that Jesus died for you. You know that he died on the cross. And you said, Lord, forgive me of my sin. But you still live just like you did. Or maybe you don't. But there's been those things in your life that you knew God was directing you and tutoring you and wanting you to take out a step of faith and have a new and a greater experience, but you didn't. And you rejected that. And he spoke again, and you rejected that. And pretty soon, you grow cold in your spirit because your fellowship with the Lord is broken. That's why it's important for you to realize that you are really a different person when you accept Jesus Christ as your Lord and Redeemer, and you read the Word, and what he tells you is your obligation to make the will valid. The will is not revocable, but you have to validate it by obedience. What are you going to do if you've missed out on that obedience? By now you've surely learned the love and the grace and the mercy of Almighty God, the long-suffering of God. And now, while you're hearing again this word and his promise, you have the opportunity to begin a new beginning. Start living on a new lifestyle. And the Lord will forgive you. He will cleanse you fresh. He will restore you into fellowship. You will hear from God. You will acknowledge and feel his presence and his spirit as you once did. Or perhaps you never have felt that. If you'll get down to business with God, you will feel it. And you will see it, and you will acknowledge that it works in your life, and that in many instances, God has used and is using you to give others hope, to give others the knowledge of his word, and to give others knowledge of his eternal will for those who will accept Jesus Christ as the remedy for their ungodliness and disobedience and maybe just downright fear and failures. So I'm saying to you, if you will listen to these first 20 verses, read them again and again, ponder them, ask God to give you some insight, you'll begin to grow. Now, verse 21. Far above all principality and power and might and dominion, and every name that is named not only in this world, but also in that which is to come, you will experience some of that on this earth before you transfer this old body, exchange it for a pile of dust to an eternal life forever that cannot be destroyed, will never be destroyed, because you accepted the will and the covenant and the promise and the wisdom and the knowledge and the teaching and the power and the authority and the directives of God the Father revealed unto us in our age through the Word of God and through the direction of the Holy Spirit as He quickens that spirit within and we're born again, converted into the kingdom of God with full and wonderful blessing. With that, let us go to communion. We know how Jesus was treated, tied to the whipping post, beaten to within very close to his life, being shattered from one end of his head to the bottom of his feet. Every portion of his body was tortured and tormented for you and me. And the Bible tells us in Isaiah chapter 53, verse 5, that by his stripes, by the whipping he took at the whipping post, we are healed. But we have to believe for it, we have to accept it, and we have to understand that even though the old flesh may send us on into eternity sooner than we think, that's okay. Or we may have to carry it longer than we think we do, or should, but the truth is still there. The knowledge in your spirit is still there. That spirit that could not hear from God, fathom the Word of God, understand the ways of God, is alive and well within you. And because of that, Jesus said, just remember what I paid for you, that you might enjoy eternal life with me. Let us eat together. Now as we take of the cup, it represents the shed blood that dropped into the ground. No doubt all the way up the trail from the whipping post to the cross. And then nailed to the cross, he shed his blood for your sin and mine. Father, I'm paying the price. It's erasure time. It's cancel time. It's time for my brother, my sister now to be cleansed and set free. And so he said, as you drink of it, remember that it requires the shedding of blood to be delivered from the law of sin and death. As you take communion, drink of this in remembrance of me. Remember what I've done for you, and it is irrevocable. You can walk away from it. You can violate it. You can fail to qualify because you have refused to live by what you knew God wanted you to live and act and be. And so as we drink of it, we give praise to Him for His perfect and wonderful love, grace and forgiveness. So in Jesus' name, let us drink together. Praise the Lord.
Thank you for listening to Christian Living 101. Remember, we are totally dependent upon your prayers and generosity. Log on to ChristianLiving101.org. There are over 300 video Bible studies there, plus many other items of interest with Pastor Applegate. We welcome your prayer requests and your questions. Please contact us at Christian Living 101. That's P.O. Box 72150 in Phoenix, Arizona, 85050. or email Gene at Gene, with a G-E-N-E, Gene at ChristianLiving101.org.